A plaster slab is a really valuable tool to have for testing clay bodies. It allows us to mix our clay as a slip or a slurry, which gives us the best possible mixing, and then dry it relatively quickly in a thin layer. This is our method for making a testing slab, and what we really like about this method is that it's really easy. You don't need a lot of tools, and you don't really have to worry about having things like a plaster blowout, which can be a huge disaster, and you really just need a couple of things that are laying around the studio. If you've never worked with plaster before, you do need to know a couple of things. Plaster will contaminate everything that it touches. And what I mean by that is that plaster is really bad to get in clay bodies and glazes. And so you really want to make sure that all the tools you use are dedicated for plaster. Okay, so once you use them in this plaster making process, you don't want to use them for other glaze or clay body uses. Keep them just for plaster. Okay, but what you need is just a couple of tools that you have around the house. First, you need a plastic tub. We like these, the shallow ones, as opposed to the deeper ones, but they work great because they're the form, and since they're one piece, they don't need any reinforcements, and they're not going to leak because you don't have any gaps or seams. So this is what we'll pour into, and we really like these. Next, you're going to need a large bucket for mixing plaster. We'll talk about the details of these later. Next, you'll need a bucket for cleaning up your plaster. You don't want to wash your hands or your tools in the sink, so you need a bucket dedicated to washing up for plaster. And you're going to need another bucket for weighing your plaster on the scale. Again, just to avoid cross-contamination. Other things you need, you're going to need a scale to weigh the plaster. You're going to need a scraper for cleanup and for smoothing out surfaces. You're going to want a metal rib. We took an old studio rib like this, we'll put a little bend in it, and you'll see that when we use this tool, but it really does help us shape it. You need some Scotch-Brite pads, some scrubby pads for, again, cleaning up edges and details. You're going to need a fan to dry out the plaster when it's been cast. For safety, you're going to want a dust mask, pretty self-explanatory, and some gloves. There is nothing toxic or dangerous about plaster. It will dry out your skin. If you are particularly hairy, it might get caught in the hairs of your arm, and then you'll have to pull it off, and that can hurt. But you know, we tend to wear gloves, just hate dry hands, so watch out for that. And that's all you'll need specifically. There are a couple of things that are worth having as optional things. Some quart containers just for moving plaster around. This is a good thing to have around and for cleanup. A drill with a mixing blade. We always use these, but do note, once you use this mixing blade for plaster, do not use it for anything else. This needs to be dedicated just to plaster. And then something soft like a towel. That's just for the demolding process. We'll talk about that later. As we were saying, you need to make sure that these tools are going to be dedicated for plaster into the future. So use some things you don't love. These farm buckets, we really like because they're easy for pouring. They've got a pouring spout, but they're also soft. And the best way to clean up plaster is to let it dry, and then you sort of squeeze the bucket, and the dry plaster will mostly crack off the edge, or if it sticks, you can scrape it off the edge with your rib. But the farm buckets, these soft rubber buckets, are for the best. These farm buckets, this size can be harder to find. Most of the time you'll see a 2 gallon variety, which is too small for this batch size. They're fine if you're doing smaller batches, but for this, it definitely will not hold enough plaster. So you want the larger size. You can use a traditional 5 gallon bucket for, you'll have for glazes or whatever around, but it's harder to clean them. You can, it'll just take more work. So we tend to use the rubber buckets. But you can use whatever else, but you definitely want it to be a 5 gallon variety just for the cleaning of it. The other thing, as we said, is you do need to have a clean out bucket. We keep one of our old rubber buckets around just for washing hands and tools and whatever we have coming through. Can't reemphasize enough, never, never, never wash anything, hands, tools, whatever, in your traditional sink. The plaster will solidify in the pipes and they will be ruined, and then you'll be very angry with yourself. We wash out in this bucket, we let that bucket dry out, and then you just dump out the dried plaster at the bottom. It works just fine, but again, dedicated for this particular job. So that's all that you really need to do this. Casting itself is super easy with this system because you don't have to prepare the tub. You don't have to put down any coatings or anything. Once you pour it and let it solidify, the slab will pretty much just drop out. We really like using these tubs. If you don't have this particular model of tub, you can use whatever you want. It really doesn't matter. But we like this big surface area, thick enough to get plenty of casts on it. And just very diverse. And we'll make a bunch of these. We tend to keep them around the studio. We'll have them dedicated. We'll have multiples. So we'll have one dedicated for porcelain and one dedicated for stoneware and one dedicated for red clay, because you don't want to contaminate those when you start drying stuff out. Mixing plaster is incredibly easy. All you have to do is to weigh out your water and then add in the appropriate amount of dry plaster. And that's basically it. But there are details to go through, so we'll talk about that here. We're gonna start out with our rubber bucket on the scale, and we're going to put it on the scale and we're going to tear it. That removes the weight of the bucket from our weighing, so it'll say zero again. The first thing that we need to do is we need to weigh out 7,938 grams of water, and that is exactly the amount of water you need for 25 pounds or 1,342 grams of plaster, which here in the States is half bag. In Europe, you may be getting a 25 kilo bag, which is 55 pounds. So you could still weigh out the, we still give you the grams, so you can do the grams here. But here in the States, we get 50 pound bags, half of which is 25. So you can get two slabs out of one bag of plaster, which is nice. Again, just to have more slabs or to have different colored clay bodies. So to start off, we have our bucket teared, and we're going to add in 7,938 grams of tap water. We're just using tap water, nothing special with it. The one thing to watch out with the water is make sure the water is room temperature or cold. Never use hot or warm water to mix plaster. It will make it set faster and it'll give you a shorter working time, and that can be a problem to be sure. So just use tap water or room temperature water. So we're going to weigh out that water, and then we're going to set this bucket aside. We're then going to take out our bucket we have specifically for batching out plaster. We keep this junky old bucket from a movie around for weighing it out. You'll notice that this bucket is not that big, and so what we tend to do is to weigh out our plaster in several segments. We're going to be weighing out 11,342 grams, so we'll do that in two 4,000 gram batches and one 3,342 gram batch. So we'll weigh out the 4,000 grams, then we'll add that to our bucket. When you're adding plaster to the bucket, you want to make sure to sprinkle it around the surface evenly. You don't want to dump it in one lump, and you don't want to dump it into one location. You want to move it around the surface so that it evenly hydrates within the bucket. You don't want a mountain of plaster in the middle. So we'll move it around the side, and I'll sift it through my fingers as we pour it in just to make sure it's dispersed, because what we're trying to do is hydrate all the granules of the plaster going in. So we'll do that twice with the 4,000 grams and one more time with the remaining 3,342 grams. We're then going to let the water sit undisturbed for 3 to 5 minutes, okay? You want to let it hydrate to make sure that all of the plaster is exposed to the water and is beginning its chemical reaction. So you want to leave it there without touching it just for a couple of minutes. After you've given it that time, it's now time to mix. We're going to do this with the drill and the mixing blade. You want to keep it down near the bottom, and you want to mix at a very low speed, right? If you mix too fast, A, it'll splash, that's no good, and B, it'll generate a lot of air bubbles in the plaster. So you want to try to move the mixing blade slow enough that it doesn't break the surface, right? So you're just agitating the material underneath. You want to move it around thoroughly, get sure you get all the nooks and crannies where the plaster may have settled. I'm only going to mix it for probably, again, a total of 2 to 3 minutes, not a long time. That should be enough, since we soaked it, to really activate all the plaster and make sure everything's homogenized. If you do not have a mixing blade, the way we like to describe it is make your hand like you're holding it straight out, like you're saying stop, and then put it down into the plaster, and then shake it like you're waving hello, and rotate your fingers around the bucket, turn your wrist to get all those nooks and crannies, again, keeping your hand about an inch away from the bottom of the bucket, and moving it around and trying to mix all the plaster and water without creating any air bubbles. And that's it. That's about all that it takes to get that mixed. But either way, just a thorough mix to make sure that there are no chunks or that the water and plaster haven't been mixed. If you have used the mixing blade, now pull it out of the plaster gently. You can tap it off to drain any plaster on it, but plaster will definitely stick to it when it's done. You can rinse it out in your plaster rinsing bucket, but not all the plaster will come out. Eventually, you mix enough plaster, you can go back and knock it off with a hammer. It'll fall off once those layers get thick enough, but in general, sort of just leave it there. Rinse off as much as you can in the bucket, but you'll definitely have plaster sticking behind, so definitely have to watch out for that. Now it's time to pour our plaster. If you feel strong enough, you can just take the bucket and pour. You do not have to pour quickly. You can pour, you want to pour more slowly, avoiding any splashing, avoiding any cavitation that'll create air bubbles, and just allow the plaster to fill up the tub pretty evenly. If you don't feel strong enough to lift that much material, you can use your quart containers and do it load by load. Again, pouring, trying to avoid splashing and bubbles, but try to get it in there as fast as possible. You probably have about 5 minutes to pour that plaster before it starts to get thick, and you need a little time to work it out. So now that all the plaster is in the tub, we want to give it a little shake, and the shake is going to level out the plaster, and it's going to bring any air bubbles to the surface. You might also try tapping the side with your knuckles and just trying to bring air bubbles to the surface. To continue to remove the air bubbles, we're now going to take our plastic scraper, and we're going to scrape it gently along the side, dragging the air bubbles to the edges of the plaster. We want to cover the whole surface, give it a little shake every now and then, try to bring up more air bubbles, and try to smooth out the surface that you've agitated with the scraper. And we'll sort of go over the surface going in perpendicular directions and just trying to bring all the bubbles to the surface. If you scrape up the sidewall with the scraper, most of the bubbles will pop. You don't have to get all of them off on the edges because we're going to carve away those edges as a finishing step in a bit once it's all set. But you really want to get all the air bubbles off the surface. They're okay on the edges, right on the edges, but in the middle, you really want to get them out and you really want to get the surface level. Once you're comfortable with how level and flat and bubble-free the surface is, then you're done. You can stop. Wash off any tools that you have to wash off in your plaster rinsing bucket. Although that said, your plaster pouring bucket, and for a lot of the tools, we'll often let them dry because it's just easier to squeeze them after they're dry and to crack that plaster off the sidewalls. It's the fastest way to clean. When you scrub, you actually will push the plaster into the plastic and it doesn't clean all that well. So most people let their plaster things dry and then just break them off if they can. But you want to let your plaster slab dry in the bucket for probably anywhere from 30 minutes to an hour. You can wait longer. The plaster is going to get warm. There's an exothermic reaction going on. And when it's cool and hard, you'll know it's time that you can demold. Like I said, half an hour to an hour is safer to wait. You can just go and do other things and let it sit there. You can leave it there as long as you want, really. It won't really cause a problem. When you come back, it should be cool to the touch and ready to demold. Demolding is pretty easy. You want to take a towel or something soft and fold it, put it on top of the plaster, and then flip the bucket over. Again, this is a little heavy. You might need a partner if you're not feeling strong enough to do it, but you want to make sure that the towel's in there because it may fall out as soon as you flip it over. It definitely may stick in the tub here, this one's sticking. So if you sort of pound on the bottom with your fists back and forth, it'll just fall out eventually. Just keep knocking, even if it doesn't fall out right away. It'll come. Gravity will do its job. There's nothing really holding it in there. So yeah, you definitely can take it out. But yeah, once it does that, we'll take the tub. We'll clean this out later, but we're pretty much done with the tub at this point. So now we want to flip the slab over, and we need to clean up the edges. You never want to leave sharp edges on a plaster mold because sharp edges are more likely to crack and chip, and that will leave chunks of plaster in your clay, and we don't want that. So we're going to smooth over these hard edges where it came up against the side of the bucket or of the tub, which is why we don't care if there are edges or bubbles on that edge. So to do that, we do it in two steps. The first thing is that we like to take our bent metal rib here and just take it down the edges. That'll sort of carve off the edges. It'll take off any high spots. We'll generally do three passes on each edge, sort of one on the top, one in the middle, and one rolled over the side, just to take down that plaster so it's relatively smooth. Once you've gone all the way around the surface, you're gonna wanna come in with your Scotch-Brite pad, dip that in some of your dirty water, your cleanup water. It does need to be wet, and then just scrub down those sides. So they're nice and rounded. Again, you're just trying to avoid chips breaking off and falling into your clay in the future. And because getting chips of clay in your plaster, definitely gonna be a bad thing. And that's about it. You know, if your surface is not quite perfect, you can Scotch-Brite the entire surface, but if you just let it level, it should be pretty smooth as is and bubble-free, so it won't take too much to do. The last thing that you need to do is clean off any residue that stuck to the plaster while you're doing the scraping and cleanup. Just wipe that off, and then you need to let the slab dry. Plaster slabs, you have to get completely and utterly dry before they are usable. It usually takes 3 to 4 days of drying. There's 8,000 grams of water in there. That's a lot. So you need to evaporate that out. So it takes time. We put it in front of a fan, just a box fan here, there. You want to elevate it if you can to get circulation around the sides. It'll take 3 to 4 days, and we would flip it every 12 hours or so, so twice a day, just to make sure you're getting circulation over everything. It's going to be cold to the touch until it's fully dry, and then it'll feel like room temperature, and that's when you know it's ready to go, when it's room temperature on all the sides. So once it's dry, you're done, and you're ready to start casting your slab. So congratulations, you made a plaster slab. Like I said, a 25-pound bag of plaster will make two of these. Although we do tend to keep three of them in our studio for testing multiple different colors of clay bodies, but two of them will serve you just fine for a long time. And even if you just want to make one, it'll get you through your needs for a good time. And now you got a plaster slab for testing clays or for reclaim or for whatever you want it for in the future. And it's small enough that you can move it around the studio. You're not stuck with some big giant plaster slab. So great. So I hope you have a good time working with plaster and get testing some clays.